All right, welcome to Where the Road Goes Midweek Podcast. Tonight we have Joshua Cutchin and Michael Hughes, and Red Pill was supposed to be with us, but alas, he could not.
Sad evening.
I believe maybe Michael and he are the same person, and they're just not telling us, but, you know, see.
Yeah. I texted everyone today and said, that's so great, at least Mike and I could seem smart for a change. We love you, Miguel.
And what are the things we were going to go over quickly, because it's been a month now, was Fortfest. We did a quick video at Fortfest about it, but there were a couple things we left out because I didn't think of it, Mike didn't think of it. So you guys were there the first night and I was not. So you want to go into, you know, what the first day was like, and actually the sort of doppelganger incident.
Oh yeah. That's right. I'll comment on the doppelganger incident because I showed up and, went to check into my room and they didn't have my name. And I said, well, maybe it's Soraya. Oh yeah, Soraya. They said he checked in already. So I thought, that's weird. I didn't think he was going to be here, but cool. I'll go check into the room, you know. So I went up and went in the room, and there's no luggage. There's no toothbrush.
No Soraya?
No Soraya, yeah. And I thought, well, maybe he travels light, you know. I mean, so, you know, I went down and I scanned the room for him. It didn't see him. And, you know, so I texted him, hey, maybe he's in the bathroom, you know? So I texted him and, he's like, no, I'm on my way shortly or something. And I'm like, okay, wait a minute. So, you know, the evil doppelganger Soraya apparently checked in just to add an extra note of weirdness to Fortfest.
Yeah, this.
Yeah, and I was thoroughly confused by that because I'm thinking, didn't he know I was coming down Sunday?
Yeah.
And you're just like, oh, okay, that's what I thought. And I'm like, okay.
And,
I didn't know about the whole doppelganger incident.
Yep.
This is probably reading too much into it, but I find it very humorous that you have had a doppelganger incident in your past, you know?
That's true. That is true. Yeah, I almost got in trouble for that one. Because I showed up late to school, and the people in the office are like, what do you want? And I'm like, I need a pass to go to class. And they're like, but you've been here. And I was like, no. And they're like, we've been watching you walk up and down the hall. I'm like, that wasn't me. And they're like, no, there's nobody else in this school that looks like you.
Wait, the school officer said that?
Yeah.
Wow. Also, I want to see.
There were two of them, too. Two of them saw me. It wasn't just one person.
This is elementary school or middle school?
Middle school. It was like maybe seventh grade.
I want to see middle school pictures of Soraya Azketh. That's what I want to see.
Totally.
I don't even know if I have any.
Nice.
I'll be totally honest with you. I avoided cameras for a very long time.
Did you exist at all?
No.
Right.
But don't tell anyone.
And then we had another 14 incident when I happened to check my email during the conference, and there was a Bigfoot sighting about 35, 40 minutes from where we were in Patuxent, one of the Patuxent National refuges or something like that. And Bigfoot, and then which made Sue Swiatek, who organized the conference, it made her go and dig up the Bigfoot sighting that was actually on the grounds of the area where day two took place, which is a giant mega mall now. But years ago, when that was being built, there was a Bigfoot sighting there. I remember that. I lived in the area, and I remember reading in the paper and, you know, asking my mom if I could, you know, drive down and check out Bigfoot.
Well, and not just a sighting, but a full-fledged flap.
Full-fledged flap, yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Full-fledged flap. I like that alliteration. But, you know, I find it passingly interesting from a sort of a culty perspective that the theater looks the way that it does, which anybody who has seen on the Where Did the Road Go YouTube channel can see the pageantry of the theater is they didn't half-ass the Egyptian theme when they made this theater. Like they
Whoa,
went all
no,
out
they
for
did not.
It.
Yeah. It's like a giant Egyptian temple, you know. I mean, it's, you know, with Anubis standing out for, no, it's like a 30-foot high statue or something.
Oh, and they're Yeah, and then there's like a Sphinx in the lobby, and like you get your tickets to the obelisk, and there are bas reliefs. It's insane. It's one of the most well themed theaters that I've ever seen. But also, you know, this idea that and I have not done my due diligence and research on this, but the idea of Arendelle as having sort of an occult meaning too, in terms of like the North Star, I believe, is what it sort of means.
Yeah, I have to correct it. It's Arundel.
Arundel. Yeah, but
yeah,
I think that's how
we say it down there.
Arundel. But I think it's still part of probably like the same etymology, right?
Probably, yeah, yeah. I've never investigated that. I mean, I grew up there all my life, you know, and never thought to think where Arundel came from.
But I think it's probably sort of part of that whole ball of wax. So it sort of makes me wonder if there's, you know, other things there that we don't that we're sort of taking for granted, you know,
synchromistic things.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Which these days really sort of floats my boat.
Yeah.
And all our presentations from Sunday are available to patrons now.
Another good reason to become one.
And I will be giving, you know, the links to you guys. So if you guys want to share them on your pages, you can do so as well.
Fantastic.
That'd be great. And
I'm probably at no time soon going to make them available to the public necessarily. So, you know, you might be able to hunt them down, or you can become a patron for $3 a month and get them a direct link.
Well, there was this great moment afterwards when Sarai, you asked me if I'd taken any pictures of your presentation, and I said no, I didn't, because I was so like I was so enthralled to see the things that you had talked about, or that you have talked about at length with us,
and with pictures. And,
well, exactly, like to put the pictures with the stories and to really get a sense for exactly what you're talking about. I mean, it's, I think you should sort of shop that presentation around in a lot of ways, because it's quite impressive, I think, in a lot of ways, because it's sort of, when you hear you talk about these sort of things, it doesn't have quite the same impact as seeing like, oh yeah, there's totally no way somebody could be shaking that tree because it's a 30-foot drop off on the other side. You know, those sort of little details.
Yeah, the only thing is I had to rush through it so much.
Yeah.
Because everything started late, and it just, I mean, it seems like anything I've ever been, unless I'm running it, everything I've ever been involved with, and it's usually music oriented, always runs late.
No, that's totally, that's a performing arts, law of the land. Yeah. That's not even.
Cause I think Mike was supposed to go on at like 2:15. And it was like, and I was supposed to have 45 minutes, and it was almost 2:00 when I went on.
Yeah, things were really pushed back. But nonetheless, I thought they were all fantastic.
Yeah, and then it turned out we didn't have to be done at 3.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I'm like, so I didn't need to rush through that, because I think mine's 23 minutes, and it was, you know, I was aiming for around 40. Mm.
I did my damnedest to blaze through mine the best I could.
But yeah, I mean, events. When I would put on concerts, I always give bands end times instead of start times.
Yeah,
I'd be like, okay, here's your rough start time, but if you want to play longer, get set up quicker, because here's where you're stopping.
Nice. Yeah, that's the way to do it.
And that way, if they took their time setting up, then they had a shorter.
Well, it's like you go to see shows in New Orleans, you know, and it's like, we start at 3. Well, really, you're starting at 3:30 a.m. You know, it's like you never expect to show up and hear it within 5 minutes of when you show up, the 5 minutes of the start time.
Right, right. But I don't know. I at one point I was booking a concert a month, and I just got really good at keeping everything right on time, which the club appreciated. Every once in a while, there were unavoidable issues.
Personality issues, I'm sure.
Not generally, like equipment issues where something just wasn't working and it wasn't the band's fault. Cause I wasn't going to penalize them for that. Or, you know, a band got stuck in traffic. I think we had a band coming from Ohio, and they had gotten completely stuck in traffic, and they were supposed to be on. And I was like, okay, changing the list up. Who's here? Okay. You're playing. All right. So, overall, Fortfest was really awesome. And that was the first presentation I ever gave.
I find that hard to believe.
Well, I have been on radio for a long time.
That's true.
It's not quite the same thing, but it's you know, it's something similar.
Yeah. I one of the talks I really enjoyed was Rosemary Ellen Guiley's talk. Mm-hmm. She and you missed that, Soraya, because you weren't there that day.
Yeah.
She talked about it's the organization FREE, which is the Dr. Edgar Mitchell Foundation for Research into Extraterrestrial Encounters. And that is, let me see, experiencer.org. And essentially what they did is very an open survey. And she's just such a great, captivating speaker. I mean, I've seen her do talks on all sorts of subjects, and they're always fantastic. But this was really interesting to me because it was a series of, I think it was four or five, Joshua, correct me if I'm wrong, really detailed surveys for people who believe.
Probably more than that, yeah.
But they were really big. I mean, they were long surveys. They collected all sorts of information for people who've had some sort of entity or contact experience. And as I mentioned to her, I think it's unfortunate that the word extraterrestrial is part of the organization's name, you know, only yeah. because a lot of these encounters, and she said, you know, some of these things, you know, did not lend themselves to being interpreted as extraterrestrial, but it's baked into the name, unfortunately. But, you know, I've loved Edgar Mitchell and all the work that he did. And it's really fascinating. I mean, she was, you know, she was talking about some of the results of these, and, you know, generally, especially when we talk about, you know, abductions and things, they seem to be very negative. You know, the stories we read, you know, going back to intruders and through Whitley Strieber and Bud Hopkins and everything, and, you know, Dave Jacobs, a lot of this, you know, it has a really dark, negative aspect, people being taken, people being hurt, you know, tortured by these bizarre medical procedures, that whole rigmarole. Well, according to the survey, the negative experiences are really in the minority. You know, but most yeah. people look at these, whatever you want to call them, contact entity experiences in a positive light. So, and the other interesting thing about this organization is anyone can go. So anyone listening who's had any sort of contact entity related experience can go and contribute to the survey. And as Joshua and I were talking back and forth to each other, that's also unfortunately kind of a drawback to looking at this. It's not any sort of, you know, even remotely controlled study. You
right.
know, it's all people who are coming to this survey and saying, yes, I have had experiences. So, you know, automatically that kind of, you know, that narrows it down to people who, you know, first of all, have found this organization, have heard about it, and who believe in this overall idea of any some discarnate or extraterrestrial or extra dimensional entities. But all that said, it's a really fascinating body of research, and anyone can go and look at the data too, which is great. It's all open sourced. And so if you're interested in that kind of thing, people listening, you know, dive into it. I've briefly dipped my toes in it. And it's fascinating stuff.
Hmm.
Yeah, it was a really great presentation. It was one of those situations where I feel like if I talk about it critically, I will sound like I was more critical of it than I was. But it was one of those moments where, sort of in line with a lot of my current thoughts, it seemed to stray so far afield of a materials paradigm that when it sort of circled back around to try to explain a possible Uber hypothesis for all extraterrestrial quote-unquote phenomena, it seemed to sort of circle back around to this materialist idea again, which just doesn't seem like it was very it's a very parsimonious way of explaining the actual reality of what people are experiencing. Mm-hmm. which would be my sole criticism. I think that's mm-hmm. a great project in terms of its transparency.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a great project in terms of the availability, and I think it's going in the right direction. I really do. I would just be a little bit hesitant to say, well, we still have to shove these experiences, which, I mean, honestly, if you listen to a lot of the free research, it sounds like it's very much consciousness based and very much based in this idea of finding deeper meaning in the fabric of reality. But then they circle back around and say, well, it's probably interdimensional beings who are doing this and that. And I'm like, no, it's not. It's probably not that complicated. Like, it's probably something a lot more simple in terms of being non-materialist, which, again, this is a drum that I've been banging for a while. Hope I don't bang it too much more often, because
no, bang away.
Well, to me, like the adherence to a certain belief is the stagnation of learning. So hopefully I'm not banging it too often, but that was the one thing that sort of made me go, huh. But it's definitely a step in the right direction, and I will go out there and say it's probably a better step in the right direction than MUFON is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, well, one interesting thing that came out, the data that stuck with me that she mentioned, is when they asked the respondents, where did these entities come from? The majority of them said they didn't know. Like, they weren't given the answer, oh, we're from Zeta Reticuli or Andromeda, right, or anything. So, you know, that was fascinating to me. That whatever these entities are, if you look at the larger pattern in all of this data, is that they're not saying they're from space. And I think we get, you know, the ufological, the nuts and bolts model has kind of skewed that. And because we hear the stories, you know, I mean, they told Betty and Barney White, you know, one star system. They told, you know, other, you know, famous contactees, you know, Venus and, you know, all that stuff. But really, when you talk the bulk of people, if we can look at this data as useful, the majority of folks are saying, well, I have no idea where they're from.
Well, and that's one of the big things that I always am self-critical, or rather critical of in terms of the ETH movement, is because we're relying on the deceptive entities to say where they're from. You know, I mean, like, mm-hmm. I live in Decula, Georgia, but when I go out of the state, I tell people I'm from Atlanta. It's not accurate at all, because there's like a 50-minute difference between where I am and where I say I am from. Mm-hmm. And I can't imagine, like, if I was trying to be deliberately deceptive, like so many things tend to seem to be, that I wouldn't sort of double down on that and say, oh, we're from space. Yeah, you can't find us. No, no matter how hard you try, we're from space. It's fine. Yeah.
Now, didn't Betty and Barney Hill, didn't Betty just see what looked like a star map, and they didn't actually tell her anything, and then someone decided they could plot out that star map somehow?
Yes. I'm not sure if they, that's exactly how it happened with the star map, and I think it was Zeta Reticuli. I think that was the first mention of that system that someone plotted. If I'm wrong, I'm sure I'll hear it from 1,000 people, but
it's the internet, you never hear that, no.
And actually, the last show we did, or maybe it was two shows ago, when we were dealing with the forum post there about us maybe not being as scientific sometimes as we should. One of the I wanted to address this real quick. I addressed it in the on the YouTube page when said person had responded to it, and he. I had used the example of seeing an article that said the biggest black hole ever has been discovered, and what they really discovered are a bunch of very powerful X-rays and gamma rays. So my argument was, and maybe I wasn't clear about this. My argument with this is that we haven't discovered a black hole. We have discovered very powerful X-rays and gamma rays. It could be a black hole, but it might not be a black hole. And his argument was, well, if it's a black hole, we're not going to see it. And that's true. But that still doesn't mean it's been a proven black hole.
Right. That's sort of a Robert Anton Wilson map territory sort of thing, isn't it? I mean,
I don't know.
Well, it's, you know, the idea that the map is not the territory. So just because you see things that would tend to suggest that it's a black hole, that might be a good indicator that it might be a black hole, but it's not proof positive that it is.
Well, also, when you look at how this became associated with a black hole, is we started picking up these strong gamma rays and X-rays from space and not knowing what they were coming from, and then someone said, well, it's a black hole. Because I don't even think that stuff was supposed to escape from black holes, but I think they figured with the rotation of the black hole and stuff, it's creating these X-rays and gamma rays. So it just kind of got thrown on there because they didn't know what it was, whereas the electric universe theory actually had an expectation to find this stuff, and I forget the exact thing that was supposed to cause it, but they had actually said, we expect to find gamma rays and X-rays shooting out of certain areas, and there's an electrical explanation for it. So when that came up, they were like, oh, well, there you go. It's not a black hole. It's this. The point is, we don't actually know what it is. All we can say that we discovered are X-rays and gamma rays. I mean, if you were trapped on an island and one side had low waves and the other side had high waves and you had to go one way or the other to try and find land, you could say, well, I'm going to go in the direction of the low waves because they don't have as much time to build up, so maybe land's closer that way. But that doesn't prove that land is closer that way. It's a, you know, you're extrapolating the data from the evidence you're looking at. It's not the same as proving it. Until you go that way and land on, you know, some kind of land where you can say, here, I've now discovered this land, you haven't actually discovered the land. You've just made an extrapolation from the data that there could be land in this direction closer than the other direction.
I'm not an astronomer, so I'm out of my league. I mean, it's been my understanding, though, that black holes are fairly well confirmed and, you know.
Mathematically.
Well, yeah, but, you know, I mean, I could be wrong. I would love to have an astronomer on to talk about it because, you know, they were. Basically, it was something that was predicted before we, you know, kind of confirmed that they existed. And now, I mean, if you ask, you know, any astronomer, they're going to say, yeah, well, it's black holes are absolutely supported by all the physics and all the data as well. So, I mean, mm-hmm. So I am not an astronomer. I don't pretend to be one on podcast and radio shows. So,
No, and you're absolutely right. The mathematics for black holes works well. It doesn't mean the mathematics are right, though. This was one of the arguments the electric universe had that physics and stuff has gone out of the lab and into pure mathematics. Now, it doesn't mean they're right, but I think we need to consider what evidence we actually have for these things and more or less use the right terms. So when we say discovered a black hole, we didn't discover a black hole. We discovered what we think is a black hole. We discovered evidence there could be a black hole there. It's not the same as discovering a black hole. I think that was my point.
Okay, I'm gonna weigh out on this one, but I trust you know what you're talking about with the, you know, the electrical universe hypothesis and everything. It's just I'm out of my league, so I'm just gonna sit here with twiddling my thumbs for a little while.
It sort of comes to me that everything we know about our current reality is very tenuous in terms of just. I'm not even talking about like what's real and what's not. I'm just talking about in terms of the way that we perceive things. In terms of the way that we interface with our current reality. So it seems to me that calls into question a lot of what we see outside of our current, you know, sphere. Not to say that there aren't observable patterns, but unless you're there in the thick of things, it might seem like there might be something that you're getting very, very wrong. And we might never know what we're getting wrong in a lot of ways.
Well, we can do an amazing amount of... We gain an amazing amount of understanding by pointing telescopes out there and working with that data. I mean, it's absolutely astonishing what we can figure out from being stuck on a planet in the corner of the Milky Way by just extrapolating from science. But you also got to figure a lot of that is probably going to end up being wrong. It's like a fish being stuck in a fishbowl. And trying to extrapolate further and further out into the environment. Well, I see a person and it walks that way. So there must be space that way. But it can only extrapolate out so far before it's just literally guessing.
Yeah, I agree to a large extent. However, I think there is sort of a threshold, you know, where we've gotten with our understanding of, you know, astronomy, astrophysics, and things like that. So I'm gonna err on the side of the the guys with the that used to wear the pocket protectors on this one, and that you know we have a pretty good understanding of things now. Where I do believe things start to break down is when we get into string theory, you know, which was basically you know mathematics created to explain things that cannot be proven, and you know, and bigger cosmological questions like. You know, how did the universe start? You know, it's the Big Bang has just been kind of enshrined as fact for so long, but there's, you know, there are models that suggest that it may not have been a Big Bang, you know, that there are other ways of talking about how the universe began. And then when we get beyond the Big Bang, it's just unanswerable stuff. But as far as certain cosmological things, I think we've got it fairly well mapped out, and I lean towards the fact that black holes are fairly well, from a completely non-astronomer perspective, but having sort of been fascinated by this stuff for a long time. But you know, dark matter, I mean, that's still up in the air. You know, I mean, that's completely. It's you know, maybe not as completely, you know, unfalsifiable and unprovable as string theory at this point, but it's still kind of a let's throw some stuff at the wall and see what sticks. And so you know, I think our where we, you know, our thresholds might waver a little bit there, but I absolutely believe you're right that you know, our models are constantly changing and being overturned, and I absolutely agree with that.
And I think if we ever get out into space, so much we think we know is going to turn out to be wrong.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that sort of comes to something, and I realize that the sport is almost the solipsistic because we can't talk about anything that we don't observe, but all of these conclusions are based upon our capacity for observation.
Yes.
And I realize that that's sort of a dead end because what else are you going to base your observations on? but yeah, I think that once we get out there in the thick of things and once we actually like are able to measure things with closer instruments, with different types of instruments, as opposed to what is basically, pretty much visual instruments, you know, visual and spectrographic instruments, I feel like we'll find that some things we thought we knew aren't quite as concrete as we thought they were, and some things are probably simpler than we thought they were.
Mm-hmm. And don't get me wrong, I love the idea of black holes. I've always been fascinated by it, and I'm not saying they don't exist. I'm just saying that I think we need to be careful with our way of assuming these things. You know, there is a distinct difference between discovering something and having a theory of this is what this means. And I think that was kind of the point I was trying to get at. Mm-hmm. It's not that, I don't think that means there's a black hole there. It certainly could. But there's other possibilities, too. And until we find a way of actually proving it's a black hole, we shouldn't be saying we've discovered it. And so let's move on to something else that is different, but also science based here, which is the Antikythera device or the Antikythera mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
And there is some new information on this. And if people do not know what the Antikythera mechanism is, it was discovered in I think it was 1902, and off of Greece, off the island of Antikythera, which is why it's called the Antikythera mechanism. And it's initially they had no idea what it was. Mm-hmm. It was just this lump of rock, but it looked like it had gears embedded on it. So in 1951, British historian Derek Sola Price began studying the find, and by 1974, he had worked out that it was, in fact, a device from 150 to 100 BC from Greece. He realized it used meshing bronze gears connected to a crank to move hands on the device's face in accordance with the metonic cycle, the 235-month pattern that ancient astronomers used to predict eclipses. Now, as time has gone on, more and more people have modeled this thing out and shown just how incredibly advanced it really is. And just in June. Yes. In June of 2016, an international team of experts revealed new information derived from the tiny inscriptions on the device's parts in ancient Greek that had been too tiny to read. Some of its characters are just 1/20th of an inch wide. Until cutting-edge imaging technology allowed it to be more clearly seen, and they've now read 3,500 characters explaining the device. The writing verifies the Antikythera mechanism's capabilities, with a couple of new wrinkles added. The text refers to upcoming eclipses by color, which means that they were viewed as having some kind of oracular meaning. Second, it appears the device was built by more than one person on the island of Rhodes, and that it probably wasn't the only one of its kind. The ancient Greeks were apparently even further ahead in their astronomical understanding and mechanical know-how than we'd imagined. Now, this article just kind of stops there, but the implications of this are pretty massive, I feel. First of all, the fact that the characters had been engraved in this metal, 1/20th of an inch wide.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like the technology to do that. We couldn't even read it until June, you mm-hmm. know? So how exactly did they put that many characters engraved that tiny into this device would be the first thing. B, it not only is it not likely the only one of its kind, it probably wasn't the first version of this complicated computer. That would be like saying our modern smartphones were the first cellular phones.
Yes, there's a widely circulated quote about this that says that it's probably indicative of undiscovered predecessors, which is exactly getting to that aspect, because this is an incredibly sophisticated device.
And if we hadn't found this, except for this one version, and there were other versions and likely previous versions that we haven't found, what else have we not found, and how mischaracterized do we have the Greeks?
Mm-hmm. That this workshop was cranking these things out, you know, exactly. Yeah. And what came before, you know, where are the prototypes, you know, where are the earlier mechanisms that just use two gears, you know, for the days of the yeah. week or something like that. Yeah, you know, unless this was some really strange, unique event on this particular island, I think it's, you know, rather unlikely. And that means there was probably all sorts of this technology around.
Well, and it's interesting to me that a lot of scholars seem to think that this possibly has its origins in Rhodes. And you think of the Colossus of Rhodes. I mean, mm-hmm. it's one of those iconic images that really push our current level of understanding of ancient cultures to the breaking point. Like, they couldn't have done that. But you know what? If they did this, they could have totally built a giant statue. I mean, come on.
No. Exactly. The other thing that I find fascinating is that, you know, this mechanism, you know, if you look at it strictly from the materialist perspective, it's an incredible computer. You know, it's computing these cycles of the planets, you know, when the timing of the Olympics, you know. But the fact, you know, that little tidbit about color being associated with the eclipses, that's an indication right there, and it absolutely fits in with the time, that it forces us to acknowledge that magic was such a part of science back in this era. I mean, why, what good did it do, you know, other than just basic knowledge to understand where the planets were in the scheme of things? Well, what it did, it allowed magicians, you know, and there's a very robust magical tradition around this time. It's the time of the, you know, where we find the Greek magical papyri. And, you know, enormous, you know, use of magic in the culture at large. So, you know, this forces us to go back and see that, you know, science and magic were intertwined. You know, this wasn't just for astronomical, you know, understanding, the planet's here, this is when the eclipse is, because where these planets were was part of of magical culture and scientific culture at the time. So it's a magical relic too. And that doesn't get mentioned in all the talk about this thing. And so, yeah, well, we're knowing where the stars and the planets and the eclipses and all these things are. Well, why? You know, they never talk about why. And that's a really important question.
Absolutely. And it's technology in the service of magic, which we haven't seen for a long time. And I don't think we will see for a long time. But like it's this understanding that this is a material device that we can use to serve the immaterial. That we can use to interact and interface with the non-material aspects of our existence. And honestly, Mike, I know you and I are both big Gordon White fans. Like reading these latest developments and just the sort of the history of the Antikythera device, Starships was just like right there in my mind, because the Antikythera device really sort of emphasizes the fact that the stars were more important than anything else to the man of yesteryear. It was their S&P, you know, it was their stock exchange in a lot of ways. Like this is what determines the way that we should live our lives and the way that we should function.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, you know, so much of what we look at today is sort of, you know, esoteric sciences and things. I mean, they flowered, you know, astrology, which was not separate from astronomy at the time. You know, in this Hellenistic era, that's where it blossomed. I mean, and you mentioned Gordon. You know, for those of you out there who are interested in this kind of interface between magic and history and culture and everything, the book Starships is astounding, and it takes it way back beyond Greece. You know, way back to really early, you know, proto cultures. That came out of Africa and spread around the world, you know, I mean, and when you think about it, of course, you know, these early cultures, what did they do? You know, what did they do in the evening? You
know? Yeah, exactly.
I mean, you sit.
No TV. Yeah.
Right. No podcast to listen to. You sit around the fire, and when you walk away from the fire and you look up, you're like, what? Look, you know, I mean, the stars had to be as big a part of early human civilization and early people and early hominids' existence. You know, I mean, how could that not? That's just such a, you know, as soon as the sun goes down, man, a whole other world opens up above you. And you know, we that aspect of our culture, of who we are, has just been kind of glossed over for so long that it's really great to see, you know, someone taking a look at it, especially someone that's looking at it through a magical lens and not just, you know, not just a completely materialist lens.
I think it speaks to, not to be anti-science, but I think it speaks to archaeology's hypocrisy that this hasn't completely overturned our ideas of what ancient man was. Modern Homo sapiens, ancient man was, because it seems so groundbreaking, and so you'd think that we would construct a device this sophisticated to address much more mundane aspects of our existence than astrology,
right? Yeah.
But the sort of implicit suggestion is, if you take the idea that like star structure, that star constellations and the passage of stars aren't important, which I don't think is a really solid hypothesis. But if you take that stance, it implies that perhaps there were other things that were. We could have applied the same technology to things that were much more mundane, like when to gather mussels on the shore, or when to, you know, when to hunt game. And it's fascinating to me that this hasn't been like a smoking gun, because the science and the archaeology behind this is pretty solid. I mean, it's not sketchy to say that this doesn't represent some sort of very sophisticated technology, but nobody talks about this. Right. Nobody, you know, this is supposedly being built during a time when people are, you know, building stone structures and still being nomads, if I'm not nomads, but are still in a very primitive stage of human development. So it's sort of this dissonance between the fact that the establishment realizes how important this is and how sophisticated this is, versus the fact that they say, well, the rest of civilization wasn't this sophisticated. It was pretty simple. It's pretty straightforward. Yeah. Pretty superstitious, actually, if you get down to it. Mm-hmm. And that dissonance just boggles my mind in a lot of ways.
Yeah, and, I mean, just in my lifetime too, since I've been, you know, into Fortiana and, you know, all this stuff, I've watched archaeoastronomy go from being something that was absolutely ridiculed. You know, the idea that I remember, you know, when people started floating the idea that Stonehenge was a calendar, you know, and all that pish posh, yeah. You know, it's yep. absurd. You know, the alignments of the pyramids, you know, all this kind of stuff. I mean, it was ridiculed. No one wanted to even talk about it in polite company. But now we have departments of archaeoastronomy and things like that. There's an archaeoastronomer right here at the University of Maryland I spoke to about this stuff. So it's taken a while, you know, to even look at alignments of you know, monuments and stone, standing stones and things like that. And even, you know, there was an article recently that some of these Mesoamerican tombs were used as telescopes. Because when you're looking out through this thing, you know, through these tombs, the way they're situated, you can see stars even in the daytime. You know, because of the yeah. way they function. So they function almost as like a telescope. But that was, well, you know, this is pure conjecture at this point, you know. And like, why is that so hard to believe? You know, I mean, it's still taking a while. But even though we're now accepting the mechanistic idea that so much of ancient life was tied to the stars, it seems like we still can't get past that to understand that the stars were part of, you know, it wasn't just to understand how things move, you know, it was to understand, you know, what they represent, how they influence us, how, you know, the Hermetic idea that, you know, as above, so below, that we're intimately connected, and that the stars and the planets, you know, which then were wandering stars because people didn't understand the concept of planets like we do now, but that they that their movements are intertwined with everything else in our reality. And we still haven't gotten to that point. That's why I think starships is such a great step in that direction. And it should just open the floodgates, I hope, for people to look at this material, you know, beyond the mechanistic sense.
And we will have Gordon White on the show in just a few weeks to talk about starships.
Excellent.
And again, when you look, not only is this device very advanced, but when you look at that writing.
Yeah.
How did they inscribe these incredibly tiny letterings and that many of them onto this device?
But this isn't really new. I mean, there are other examples of ancient art, if I recall correctly, and I can't cite any of those at the moment, but I do recall correctly that there are other examples of ancient art that have very minute inscriptions involved,
mm-hmm.
Which, you know, you can invoke the idea of magnifying lenses, which isn't that far off of the realm.
Not
of
at all. No, they exist. I mean,
right.
We have examples of lenses. So, you know, there was lens technology back then.
So it's,
well, even, sorry, go ahead. Even with Göbekli Tepe, one of the things about the inscriptions on those stones is those stones are fairly thin. So the chances of breaking them by inscribing them was fairly high. And that was one of the impressive things about the inscriptions on those stones and the carvings on those stones was that they were done on these very thin stones without destroying
mm-hmm.
them.
Mm-hmm. And therefore aliens.
Right. And you have things in Egypt as well that have been inscribed where they have no idea how they did them without destroying the device.
Precisely, and to me, all this sort of adds up to this idea that the past was more advanced than we acknowledge, and I don't think that necessarily means that there was some sort of exterior influence in us arriving at that conclusion.
Well, I think we should note too that it's not that all these inscriptions were so small; it's the fact that a lot of them were corroded as well, and they needed like X-ray and other forms of scanning technology to interpret them. So that, you know, so a lot of this newly revealed writing is due to technology being able to read this stuff.
But still, 1/20th of an inch wide for each letter is pretty freaking small.
Yeah, that's awfully good. Good eyes those Greeks had.
But go ahead.
And I don't think they would have done it if it was that difficult to do. That's the other thing. Like a lot of this stuff, I don't think they would have moved these gigantic blocks if they were that difficult for them to move.
Mm-hmm. And one of the bigger implications of the Antikythera device is that it suggests to me, what have we not discovered and will we never discover that was even more sophisticated? Because it implies that, I'm like, to think that this one relic is the most sophisticated thing from a civilization that will ever be discovered or that existed, it seems to be a bit folly. I mean, because if our current paradigm has anything to show for it, the more advanced technology gets, the less and less permanent it gets. And I sort of wonder, like, what else is there that we weren't even aware of?
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And you wonder, you know, it makes me wonder why we haven't found more of these things. Like, were they hoarded, you know, were they hidden? I know the ship that was carrying the Antikythera mechanism, it had all kinds of other like expensive stuff on it, you know, so maybe this was going, you know, maybe these were sort of, you know, the super duper technology at the time, and there were, you know, the craftsmen that were making them made a limited number, and they went to, you know, people who could afford something like this, you know, something that clearly took such an enormous number of hours to craft this thing and put it together, you know, so maybe this was just super high-end technology, but maybe there were, you know, smaller, you know, versions of it, you know, the knockoff, you know, iPhone, you know, that's made in China versus, you know, the high end ones that the people in the West that can afford such things buy.
And how many things came before it?
Yeah.
You know, before they got to this point, and
what happened to them? Exactly.
Were they just, you know, destroyed because they were inferior now that there was a new model?
Yeah, or you know, were they hoarded? You know, I mean, it's a question that doesn't have an answer, but it's fascinating to think about this. You know, it would be very unusual if this one workshop, you know, this one group of craftsmen managed to put something so complex together, and that didn't ripple out somehow. You know, or the antecedents of this thing didn't exist. You know, something this remarkable just doesn't drop out of the sky from the gods. Although, you know, maybe that's another way to think about it.
The aliens came down and showed them how to make it. And...
Yeah, you know, I feel like, you know, Gordon should cut me a check the way I'm keep pipping his book and pushing it, but it's, you know, the idea that we're, and this broadens into a completely other, you know, giant topic, but the idea that some of what we see as technological, if we stop looking at it as maybe, you know, given to us by contact with aliens, and we start looking at it as maybe this stuff developed through contact with other sorts of entities out there. Spaceship beings, you know, that maybe through some sort of other contact with gods or spirits or whatever you want to call them, that's how some of these ideas start to enter human consciousness.
Well, and
I mean,
I was going to say that's sort of the central thesis is that intelligence can come influenced by the stars and not necessarily be ET. You know, they can be intelligences that are tied into what we observe from outside this planet, but not be little green scientists coming down and spacecraft. Yeah, sorry.
And it's also possible that some of this stuff was knowledge that survived from a previous civilization.
Yeah.
I mean, yes. we know the world pretty much had an Armageddon at the end of the last ice age. This is becoming more and more clear. And that's another thing that, you know, 10, 20 years ago was like, no, that didn't happen. And now we're getting more and more evidence that, yes, that's exactly what mm-hmm. happened. And if there was a culture here, and we know there was to some degree from things like Göbekli Tepe, what happened to it and how advanced were they? And was any of that knowledge carried down? Because it seems like most of the myths around the world suggest that that knowledge was carried down in one form mm-hmm. or another. So to what degree did that influence things like this? To, you know, was there a small group of people who were, you know, transmitting that knowledge that, you know, were able to build stuff mm-hmm. like this? Or move large monuments and large stones easily with the general people just didn't understand how it mm-hmm. was done? You know, the idea of sound technology gets thrown around a lot. And I mean, we're working on various forms of levitation with sound technology. So who knows what we may have had that we'll never discover the pieces for, especially if we don't know what we're looking mm-hmm. at. You know, something that looks like just an anomalous piece of junk may have had a very technical, it may have been a high piece of technology at one right. point.
I mean, you know, imagine somebody finding, you know, a smartphone and looking at, you know, oh, you know, it looks just like a polished piece of glass, you know, oh, this, and, you know, and it, okay, ooh, maybe these people looked into it and scryed, you know, or maybe it's, oh, maybe they used it to check their makeup or whatever. You know, I mean, it's all about context too. You know, if a certain type of civilization found things that we have and they're no longer operational, yeah, they might just walk right by it.
Well, if you look at the Antikythera device, I mean, like, I would have found that on a scuba dive and been like, wow, that's a really unique piece of coral, or like, you know, it's a porthole that has some crust on it. I would have never thought that it would be as important or intricate as it is, you know.
Yeah, neither did the first people who found it. You know, they're like, oh, this is cool. Well, we don't know what it is, but it looks kind of interesting.
Yeah, well, you can tell there are gears there, but you don't understand the complexity of it until they started x-raying it and modeling right. it out. And it said the first guy who did it, I mean, he started studying it in 1951, and it took him until 1974 before he had worked out what it was.
Mm-hmm. And again, it boggles the mind that this isn't like item number one on your archaeology 101 syllabus. Like, it feels like it should be like the most important thing in terms of us understanding our past. But
yeah.
You walk up to somebody on the street and you ask them about it, and they don't know about it at all.
Yeah.
No. I think people who are into Fortiana and the paranormal and lost civilizations, they know about this because it's one of those things that archaeology does not deny.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like Göbekli Tepe in that sense where they go, yeah, okay. That's that old.
Yeah. When we said that there was, you know, people were just hunter-gatherers and could never do something like this, yes, they were actually doing it. Yeah, it's, you know, as someone who's been into this stuff for a long time, you know, I have to admit there's a bit of schadenfreude, you know, watching, you know, mainstream archaeology have to sort of admit some of this stuff finally. And this is a perfect example of it, you know, and it's just there in their face, you know, and it's what it is, and it has to change the way we look at technology and a whole lot else about, you know, Hellenistic Greece.
And I mean, there's other examples of stuff like this. There's the soil, and I forget the name of the exact soil. I know they're actually studying it in Cornell, and I keep meaning to try and see if I can figure out which lab is looking into it and talk to them about it. But it was found in South America, and it's incredibly fertile, and it was created, and we can't replicate it. So whatever the ancient cultures did to make this soil so incredibly fertile, you know, it's beyond our understanding. And it seems like a simple thing. It's soil. You know, it doesn't come across as like a smartphone or something, but it's a form of technology that we can't explain from an ancient source.
Well, yeah, this is something. Sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was going to say that.
Hold on. Jinx, show me a coast.
You go first, Mike, please.
Well, hang on. It's called Terra Preta, yeah. If anyone Terra wants Preta. To look it yeah, up. It's yeah. the magic soil of the lost Amazon.
One thing that we do know now about that soil is a lot of it was because a large portions of the Amazon were terraformed by burning and planting. Mm-hmm. You know, we look at it today as, you know, this pristine rainforest and all, but we now know that a lot of the richness of the soil was because there was extensive terraforming by ancient people by burning huge swaths of land and the way they used agriculture. Yeah, which you know, we don't want to, we just want to think of this as just this pure primitive land, but it's become, I think it's been known for a couple of decades now that large portions of it were deliberately burned in order to create that soil, those soil conditions where people could grow their crops. And it's only a, you know, recent historical development that it's become, you know, this vast, you know, primeval jungle sort of yeah. habitat.
Which is an extreme irony, the fact that it's become, and this isn't an anti-environmentalist agenda viewpoint at all for me, but like I find it sort of ironic that the poster child for environmentalism is the product of some sort of intelligent terraforming design.
It's quite
a conundrum.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think it has to be done right.
Of course. Like, you can't, like, yeah. It's, yeah. You have to be responsible.
The problem with our culture is... Yeah.
But we just think ancient people didn't know what they were doing, you know. And it's clear in a lot of ways they actually knew quite well what they were doing and changing and manipulating and modifying their environment.
And when you... when you look at the whole South America situation, it was thought to be jungle the whole time. There was never a culture, even though there were plenty of stories of cultures existing there. And again, we ignored those legends and those myths because, well, those people don't know what they're talking about. And it wasn't until we had, I think really what set it off was our satellite technology.
Mm-hmm.
Where we started to be able to see the remnants of old structures and fields and things like that throughout throughout South America.
And, you know, the other bit of schadenfreude while we're sort of on the subject of what's changing in archaeology, anthropology, is watching dates of everything get pushed back deeper and deeper into time, you know. Contact the idea that, you know, ancient people were just, you know, stuck wherever they were. I mean, you know, we understand now that they were traveling all over the place, that cultures mingled, that they traded. It's great because every single week another piece of evidence pops up. It's like this stuff is just undeniable now. It's kind of like a tsunami of evidence that just keeps pushing things further and further back in time. And it's great, you know, because there is the mainstream is finally having to accept this stuff because we can date things so much better now. You know, you can't just stick it in a drawer and pretend it doesn't exist anymore. So it's such a great time for someone who's, you know, like us, who have suspected all of these things, suspected that the story that we've been told is incomplete or even wrong. You know, now we're seeing it verified, and the people who've been telling us that we're wrong all this time, they're finally having to, you know, eat some crow.
Yes, the same people who were spitting in Robert Schock's face.
Exactly.
The and like people like David Hatcher Childress would always say that, you know, oceans were freeways; they weren't obstacles
exactly,
to ancient people.
Exactly.
And you had the whole Kon-Tiki expedition, which proved that, you know, you could in primitive boats, you could go across the Pacific Ocean.
It ties
Ocean.
Into the stars again. You know, it's another place where, you know, stars were the way of, they were the GPS, you know, I mean, that's how you got around. Another reason why they're so important in a practical sense, as well as in a mythic sense.
And so just to define Terra Preta a little bit better, it's a black Earth-like anthropogenic man-made soil with enhanced fertility due to high levels of soil organic material and nutrients such as nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and calcium embedded in a landscape of infertile soils. Terra Preta soils occur in small patches averaging 20 hectares, or about 50 acres, but 350 hectare sites have also been reported. These 2,000-year-old man-made soils occur in the Brazilian Amazon Basin and other regions of South America. Terra Preta soils are very popular with the local farmers and are used especially to produce cash crops such as papaya and mango, which grow about three times as rapidly as on surrounding infertile soils.
Yeah, I mean, these guys were soil scientists.
And if I remember right, it doesn't actually drain the soil of nutrients, which is one of the things about it. You can just keep planting in it year after year, and the soil continues to be incredibly fertile.
Yeah, it's amazing, you know. And there's a corollary for me with that, with the development of like substances like ayahuasca, you know, which is this you know, admixture of plants that has this really, you know, powerful, unique effect on the human nervous system. That, you know, I mean, it was it just simply, you know, I'll throw some of this in there and some of this in too, and boil it down and see what it does later, you know? Or, you know, that's the, well, maybe it was happenstance, but maybe there's, you know, maybe there are other ways of knowledge that, you know, these, you know, allegedly such primitive folk had access to.
And if you ask the ancient shamans and stuff, you know, how did you discover this ayahuasca? They'll say
exactly,
well,
the plants told us. Right? Yeah, exactly. And
we just throw that out. That's just superstition. That's nonsense. Well, maybe it's not, because you know 90% of what they seem to tell us turns out to be true after you know time.
And if they can, you know, so how did they create this incredible form of soil? You know. That we still don't understand how to make ourselves, or you know, how did they do that? Well, maybe the plants told them that too. You know, it's certainly something I give a lot of credence to, but you know, we're weirdos.
Well, and to take sort of an even further woo step, I would be inclined to suggest to people to consider. A lot of caveats there. The possibility that a lot of the developments and advancements that mankind has made have been fostered or shepherded by some sort of outside source. And take that as you will. If you're a religious person, you'll probably take that to mean God. If you're a pagan person, you'll probably take that to mean like earth spirits. But I would suggest that a lot of the things that have been tugging at our sense of possibilities, or a lot of the things that we consider technologies have been sort of engineered into us by something. Collective unconsciousness, maybe. Other spirits, perhaps. But if you look at like the history of chemistry, the history of the discovery of DNA, the history of this discovery of ayahuasca, all these things tend to point to some sort of exterior source, at least exterior in the individual sense. It seems to suggest that we're being nudged along by some sort of intelligence. And I think that's sort of if you are availed of the literature and these sort of aspects, that seems to be a relatively fair statement to make.
Yeah. And there's a modern example of it with the concept of, and I'm not sure how to pronounce the guy's name, so I'll probably mangle it, but Kekulé came up with the idea of the carbon ring by having a dream of an Ouroboros, a serpent biting its tail, you know. So, and DNA, Crick allegedly thought up the double helix of DNA structure under the influence of LSD. You know, so we have modern examples of, you know, dramatic shifts in our knowledge and our understanding and our technology through visionary altered state experiences.
Yeah, absolutely, absolute parallel in that sense. And I think that's sort of like when natives of the Amazon River Basin say the vine calls, or that we just, I think they're sort of getting at that too, because all the origin myths tend to suggest that it was given to them by a deity, the Yage brew. Mm-hmm. So I think that's sort of getting at the same thing. And, you know, I wonder if that really grafts onto modern technology, or if the fact that it doesn't perhaps speaks to the fact that we're going down the wrong path.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is a really good point.
Hmm. So this kind of leads into something else I wanted to bring up today, although it may seem very different. But I was watching an older movie. I think it came out around 2000 called The Body. Either of you familiar with this? That. It's Antonio Banderas.
Nice.
And a friend of mine lent it to me, said it was really good. And basically in the movie, an archaeologist in Jerusalem finds what she believes to be the tomb of Christ. And, of course, this starts off a whole political, religious freak out. You know, and a lot of it has more to do with the politics of the thing. But it got me thinking, because obviously the religious implication of this is that if they find the body of Christ, the skeleton of Christ, then he didn't physically rise to heaven.
Mm.
Now, of course, there's old Christian texts that say, you know, Christ was just a man, he wasn't divine, so on and so forth. I mean, if you look through some of the old the original stories, there's a lot of contradiction from one to another before they accepted one specific version of it. But it started me thinking about, you know, they're going, the one guy's saying things like, well, if he didn't rise from the grave and go to heaven, then there's nothing after death. And, you know, and there's that sort of quick, oh, that's it. It's either this or that. But I also started thinking, why are we more likely to believe something like the teachings of Jesus were very good, positive teachings. Why did he have to be divine for them to matter? And when we look at like channeled stuff, like if Jane Roberts had simply wrote the books instead of saying she was channeling it from Seth, would anyone have cared? If Carlos Castaneda didn't have Don Juan and was just writing books of research on the Aki Indians or these methods of altering consciousness, would they have gone anywhere? Now, I don't want to say that everyone needs that kick of something supernatural to believe in, nor do I want to attack anyone's beliefs. I'm not trying to undermine what anyone believes about any of this stuff. I'm just wondering why it seems that a large part of our population is more likely to listen to something that has a supernatural source over, say, a smart person or an enlightened person.
It gives it, you know, an extra je ne sais quoi. I was being silly there, with my French, but no, it gives it an extra kick, right? You know, if I come out and say, here's my plan of ethics for human beings, it might, you know, people might say, oh, that's good. It's interesting, you know, but if it's coming from God, if it's coming from, you know, a mythical shaman, if it's coming from a channeled entity, that gives it a little more gravitas to some people, you know, to people who are inclined to believe that way. You know, it's certainly not going to, it's actually going to marginalize it, to someone who's, you know, a very much a materialist or, you know, doesn't believe in that kind of stuff. But, why? I mean, that's such a great big question.
It is. It is a very big question.
I think it's partially tied into a modern 21st century aesthetic. I mean, if you look at the ironic thing is that if you look at the smartest people pre 21st century, even a little bit pre 20th century, I think by and large, and I'm sure someone will skewer me for this at some point, but I feel like by and large, most of them acknowledge some sort of higher form of organization in the cosmos. But at some point, this materialist thing crept in to such a pervasive extent in the 21st century that it has become sort of the rule of the land in terms of how people are supposed to approach science. It's this idea that things cannot be one nor the other, and there is this trend that has emerged, which I don't think is entirely unfair, that smart people are non-superstitious. Having said that, I think that it's sort of an extremely non-nuanced view.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, really, historically, the roots of that separation are in the Enlightenment. You know, when reason became exalted and you know, the superstitious, you know, the religious became sort of, you know, the world became disenchanted. I've been thinking about that a lot lately, looking at it as the disenchantment of human perception. You know, the idea that we throw all that stuff away, and it really began in the Enlightenment. I mean, that's when that knife came down and started cutting things away, like they are cut today. And as we became a more, you know, as technology just continued to steamroll, you know, it became a lot easier to say, well, you know, the scientific outlook is the key to progress. And to me, it feels like we're kind of starting to see that the purely materialist worldview is, you know, for all the good that it's done us, is also, you know, it's driving us into a ditch as a species. So that's why I see a lot of interest in you know, consciousness, and altered states and magic and, you know, myth and things like that. I feel like there's, you know, that's sort of the species kind of trying to put the brakes a little bit on, because we're feeling that disenchantment even more so nowadays. You know, we're living in this era where we've got this, you know, this incredible technology in our pockets connecting us to the global brain. But we still have people who are blowing up other human beings, you know, for the most absurd, ridiculous reasons. And, you know, so it feels to me like that the cycle is the cycle where reason is exalted. I think a lot of people are just sort of struggling. I mean, they also see the drawbacks of superstition and fundamentalism. What that's done to us and what that's doing to us every day, you know, when we read the news. But there's this, to me, you know, I've always felt like I've kind of, you know, I've rode the wave of the zeitgeist. You know, I feel like I seem to feel the trends as they're sort of coming together, as the waves starting to build. And to me, it really feels like we're moving into sort of a post-reason era, where we still view science as a positive force, but we're also questioning where we've come. And we're seeing, as we've talked about so many times on the show, we're seeing some parts of the scientific worldview start to crumble at the same time.
And when you mention Crick, I mean, he supposedly got the double helix from an LSD trip.
Yeah, exactly.
Yet he didn't come out and say that. So, I mean, because he didn't want to admit this information came from a source beyond just the thinking mind.
And Carrie Mullis, who developed the technique that's used to replicate DNA, and it's, of course, unfortunately slipping my mind right now, but the fact that we can study DNA in large quantities like we do, Carrie Mullis also came up with that technique on LSD, you know. So we've got two scientists who have made, you know, incredible contributions to our understanding of human biology, who developed their ideas, you know, in an altered state.
Yeah, and I would sort of piggyback on all this to say that the people who think that that magic doesn't have a power have never tried it in any some sort of serious sense of the way. And I mean that in terms of, not only in terms of like ritualistic magic, but in terms of like, to be broad and sort of boring and blunt about it, in terms of prayer as well. I mean, like there is something going on at that level that anyone who says it doesn't have any power just hasn't really engaged with it in a full and earnest way. And that's the thing, is to engage with these things in a non-ironic, non-detached way, to just sort of say, hey, I'm going to put my all into this, and if, mm-hmm. hopefully something will come out of it. And yeah, if you do that, shit works. It really does. Yeah. It really does.
Yeah. It's, I mean, the, you know, I go back to Crowley's, you know, definition of magic, which is, you know, it's changing your, it's, you know, all in a nutshell, it's changing your consciousness in conformity with your will, you know, and yes. So much of what, you know, the whole New Age movement, you know, gets in, you know, kind of a simplistic way, or even, you know, going back to the positive thinking movement, you know, that Mitch Horowitz, you know, is chronicles so very well, and he's really kind of, he's bringing that to a new awareness to a lot of people. But it's about your changing your consciousness, which changes your circumstances. You know, and people look at magic and say, well, yeah, you think you can, you know, burn this incense and pray to this god and you'll get a job that you want, you know. Well, it's more about burning the incense, praying to the god so that you change your consciousness in a way that allows you to be more likely to get that job, you know. And
right.
So it's all... one of my favorite quotes from Peter Carroll, chaos magician extraordinaire, is that, you know, magic works in practice, not in theory. And that's exactly what Joshua just said. You need to engage with this stuff, whether it's, you know, through a Christian perspective, whether it's through, you know, a ceremonial magic, whether it's through, you know, the secret kind of, you know, law of attraction stuff, whether it's positive, the positive thinking movement. If you engage with it and you change your consciousness, it works. And you may not be able to explain how it works. I still can't. You know, I've spent right. my life trying to, you know, wrap my head around how this kind of thing works. But if you engage with it and you put it into practice, it works. And you don't have to understand why. It just does.
In watching the body, they had, you know, one of the big things is the church was saying, well, if this is Christ, it's going to cause so many people, you know, they're going to lose their faith. People are going to kill themselves, so on and so forth. You know, and my initial thought was, well, then you just proved he existed.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it kind of kicked in. Okay, now I understand why this would be a problem. But one of them says, it doesn't matter. Most people won't believe it.
Well, it sort of circles back around to what we talked about in the last midweek, I think, about just the idea of extraterrestrials undermining a faith in a supreme creator, or a faith, religious faith.
Right. Like,
none of this really matters. If you actually have a real sense of faith about, like, the fact that there is something behind the scenes pulling all the strings and working in the favor of people who acknowledge its existence and respect its existence and try to do good, then who gives a damn? You know? Like, yes. That's what I always keep on coming back to. And again, this might not be great Christian theosophy, but... It's sort of where I've landed in my own personal journey.
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's something else Crowley said that I always liked, and I'm sure I've said it on the show before, but he said basically God is a mountain, named different things by different people and approached it with different ways to the top. you know, and different paths to the top, but it's still the same mountain. I'm paraphrasing what he said. And I always felt that that was dead on. I mean, you can find God by being a Christian, but you can also find God from being any number of other religions and spiritual practices and so on and so forth. It doesn't mean one is right and the others are wrong.
As long as the golden rule holds true, loving thy neighbor as you would yourself, and putting, you know, the eternal other, the existence of all, the essence of all creation above yourself, that those are the two sort of universal ideals in all sorts of religions, and those things seem to be like the bedrock of what it means to be a good person and to attain access to the other, you know.
Agreed. Although I don't think you always have to put the other ahead of yourself necessarily.
Fair enough. Yeah, that's certainly fair too. I was thinking the same thing.
I mean, but you do find a few examples, like Buddhism does not have a deity as its source of information.
So I would sort of amend that to be respect and acknowledge the existence of said other.
Okay, all right.
Which I feel is sort of an important component. I don't think it's essential, but I think it's sort of an important component.
Well, sure, because you're not going to have much of a spiritual journey if you don't think there's anything there.
Right.
Well, it's interesting that you brought up the body and that question, because I just read a fantastic book. I mentioned it to Joshua offline, by Richard Smoley, who is the editor of Gnosis magazine, which is a great magazine back in the late 80s, early 90s, while it existed. And it's called When God Became God. And it's a look at the Judeo-Christian conception of God and how that developed historically. I recommend it to anyone who's listening who's interested in that subject. And what he really drove home is that there's such a disparity between mainstream Christian belief as it is espoused from the pulpit and in the churches, and the understanding of academics in theologians. You know, these are Catholic theologians, Protestant theologians, and the huge disparity in these beliefs. And when you look, you know, if you talk to the average Protestant sitting in a church about, you know, the beliefs of their faith, and then you go talk to the guys in the seminaries that are producing the preachers and the reverends and things, there's such an enormous difference. Academic understanding of Christianity. I mean, essentially, if you ask religious academics, theologians, about the three magi who came to visit Christ, they'll say that didn't happen. And if you look at all of these elements from the Bible, historically, we know certain things were probably made up. We know Jesus, almost all of them agree that Jesus did exist, okay? That he existed, right. That he preached a certain message at a certain time. But when you look at the Gospels, even the Gospels, like there are, I think it's Luke, and Joshua, you probably know more about this than I do. Luke is the most agreed upon chronology amongst Christian academics. Mm-hmm. And the later gospel writers kind of built upon that. So we look at the stuff that's in Luke and we say, well, this was more contemporaneous to when Christ lived and what he said. And none of the gospel writers were actually around. They all agree on that. All of this stuff comes a little bit later. So it's interesting to me as, like, you know, the evidence based kind of guy, but also the guy that really resonates with the Christian, the Jesus message, you know, not necessarily what it became. And it's just fascinating to me that you have all these people sitting in churches that are, you know, that believe so much stuff that they're, you know, the people who are in the seminaries who are then going out and talking to these folks who, you know, the people in the seminaries, like, well, actually, We don't want to tell the flock this, but actually, you know, this probably didn't happen and this probably didn't happen. But we're kind of sure that this happened and this happened. So I mean, anyone who's interested in, you know, theology, biblical archaeology, biblical studies, it's a really great book from a guy who is, you know, he's not anti-Christian but in any means, you know. He's very drawn to the persona of Christ and what he taught, but it's also really based in the understanding of the history that we know. It's a great book.
Well, and hell, if you're a Christian, you should be able to read anti-Christian writings. If you're a Muslim, you should be able to read anti-Muslim writings. If you're a Jew, anti-Jewish writings. Like, it's all part of, like, you have to be able to process the larger world around you, or else you're, like, at least acknowledge your cognitive dissonance, or else you're living in your own bubble. Exactly. And I think that's an important part of faith that people don't, nobody talks about, honestly. One of my favorite pieces of fiction, we talked sort of, again, about this on the last podcast, about, like, pieces of fiction not being true, but being true in the Patrick Harper sense of, like, right, being right, true to the spirit of things, but not being literally true. Have either of you, one of you read Christopher Moore's book, Lamb?
Fantastic.
No.
Mike, I mean, yes. Yeah.
Yes.
It's one of those great moments, because I believe in that book, Christopher Moore posits the, it's entirely a fictional work, and it's quite a humorous and almost scatological work in terms of the standpoint of Christ's buddy Biff. but one of the things I love about the book is that the three magi were apparently, I believe in the book, roughly they were like roughly a sort of, I mean, obviously Buddhism wasn't a thing yet, but sort of an Eastern, a Far Eastern mystic, a Near Eastern mystic in the Hindu sense, and I believe like sort of a pre-Muslim mystic were the three magi in that book, which I thought was a wonderful little twist on really the reality of what all this is. I mean, you know, again, I'm sure there's some people out there who are saying I'm not doing Christianity right, but whatever, hell with them. But the idea that we're all sort of getting at the same thing, you know, this idea that Sarai's talked about earlier, like spokes on a wheel. It's that that blind man and the elephant allegory. Everybody's feeling different parts of the elephant and feeling like they're seeing, oh, this is a leaf, this is a snake, this is a tree trunk. No, it's all an elephant. You're just feeling different parts of it. And I think that really sort of gets to the core of that in sort of a nice subversive fictional manner.
And also Buddhism started about 5 centuries before Christianity.
Oh, so I had that backwards. So Islam was after Christianity and Buddhism was before. Sorry.
Yeah.
Yes. And there are some people who feel that, in fact, Paul Davies, who I had on, did a documentary called Jesus in India, where they speculate that in some of the lost years of Jesus, he had gone to India and learned Buddhism.
Yeah, there's...
And what he brought back to Europe was kind of a westernized version of Buddhism, and they are similar in a lot of ways.
Well, not only are there those lost, like sort of missing years of Christ's life, but there's also a theory that Christ just sort of went into the East, allowed Judas to take the fall for what he did, and sort of went into the East and preached a form of the gospel, yeah, and died, you know, and I think there's a Japanese tradition that says that's what happened, which is fascinating. Mm-hmm. I mean, at the end of the day, if you follow a discipline and believe in the other, like, you have to be flexible enough to the fact that any sort of real revelation doesn't really sway you from your own path. Not in the negative sort of I have blinders on sense, but in the sense that whatever I'm doing, I'm trying the best at what I'm doing, and it will lead me to a certain sense of peace and a certain truth. And I think that's what is missing from almost all religious discourse nowadays. Is
you
the fact
are
that we
not
need
kidding.
To... so this makes sense, right?
Yeah. I look at it's fundamentalism that is really that the Zika virus of the human society, I think. I mean, it shrinks mm-hmm. our brains. And we're looking at it every day, what's happening, you know, as history is being wiped out in the Middle East by, you know, psychopathic yeah. fundamentalists, as in the US, you know, crazed fundamentalists are, you know, are loading up for, you know, the violent revolution and things like that. I mean, it's just absolutely, and that's what makes me feel like, you know, this the wave of reason has crested, and it's just resulting, you know, it has its positives, and that people are starting to think a little more outside the box as far as consciousness and you know, and the way our consciousness works in the matrix of reality. But it's also, you know, pushing people back to these, you know, insane beliefs, you know, these strict fundamentalist beliefs and these, you know, writings of human beings that became sacred, you know, writ. But you know, we're you know, fairly broad-minded people talking to fairly broad-minded people. And unfortunately, there's a rising tide of, you know, anti-reason and fundamentalism, and you know, and that's the big toxin of humanity right now, I think. So yeah.
Absolutely.
If only everyone listened to this podcast, the world would change for the better.
But even if they listened, the people who have already set up their mind that they're right aren't going to change that very easily. And it doesn't matter if you're talking about religion or what you're talking about. Anyone who is absolutely certain they're right is probably wrong. Because I think we're all wrong. None of us have the complete picture. It's all perspective. It's all our life experience, what we've been taught, what we've encountered. So everyone has a completely different experience. No matter how many similar points we may have, we all see the world differently. So none of us has any kind of corner on the truth other than our own.
This is something that's really been sticking for me lately, is we are our technology, the curse of our technology, the curse of our social interactions. Like, you know, back in the visionary days when I was hand coding HTML websites, you know, there was all this visionary Stuart Brand sort of talk about, like, you know, the internet is going to break down the barriers and bring us all together as human beings. You know, there's not going to be any more arbitrary lines of, you know, countries and states. It's all going to bring us together as this collective force of good. But a perfect example of this, there's a website, I think it's called Red Blue State or something like that, and it takes liberal Facebook posts and feeds and news items and puts right next to them conservative Facebook posts and feeds. And it is such an interesting exercise to sit and look at them side by side. Because, yes, technology did bring us all together, but now, because of the way we filter things, we're you know, if you are a, you know, if you're a fundamentalist Christian that believes, you know, the Second Amendment is, you know, the key to saving this country, you've got all of your, you know, your inputs are feeding you that. If you're an anarchist leftist who believes that the state is the enemy, and your feed is feeding you all that stuff. So it's fascinating that, you know, this technology that could be bringing us all together, we're building these little prisons of ideas that we stay within. You know, and so we're, you know, instead of opening us up to other ideas, in a lot of ways, the way a lot of technology is currently implemented, it's actually sealing us off and building us these tighter walls around us of what we see and what we listen to and what we read.
The exception there would be cat photos.
Yes, cat photos bring us together. And goats, which are the new cats.
Right.
You know, this sort of harkens back to something that I have views that I think I'm just rational enough that people, when they hear them, they're like, really, you think that? And I try to talk to them and like walk them through the way I feel like I do. But like, I try to keep my personal views relatively close to the chest. But at the same time, I try to live every day whenever I see something that conflicts with what I think, I try to take that to heart and be like, am I completely, completely wrong about this? Religiously, mm-hmm. politically, philosophically, any of those things. And I think that more people would benefit from that. Like, just take 5 minutes to say, maybe I'm completely wrong and maybe I'm a jerk, you know, or maybe I'm doing the wrong thing for the right reasons, or the right thing for the wrong reasons. And if everybody would just do that, that's like the solution to making the world a better place. I really do think so. Like this sense of self-doubt, not in terms of a lack of confidence, but in terms of an empathy that we should all really share between each other.
That's classic again, Robert Anton Wilson, in question your BS. Like, yes. Question other people's BS, which he termed belief systems, but it also is BS. And yeah. But question your own BS. That is really the key. And also be able to, you know, it's like to get political, but I won't get into the elements of it. But the whole idea that, you know, people who are protesting, you know, police brutality against Black people can also believe that killing police men is also a bad thing. You know, the idea that you can't correlate multiple, you know, sometimes paradoxical or conflicting beliefs in your mind at one time. You know, or to put it more in our terms, that you can't, you know, respect the scientific process while also believing that there are other ways of accessing truth and reality other than through strictly science. So, you know, as much as it is questioning your own BS, it's also being able to hold paradoxical positions in mind instead of falling for the easy, you know, dichotomy that's presented to you. Oh, I'm pro this, so I must be against that,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's the Terrence McKenna thing of being willing to sit with the ambiguity and like embrace it, like just sit with that. Say like it's not always true. It's not always not true. Here are general trends, maybe not. Actually, even more so than the BS quote from Robert Anton Wilson, my favorite one is the something about like the totally convinced and the totally stupid have too much in common to be. to be resembling an accident, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
it's just to be able to accept outliers into your worldview and to say that, you know, there might be a problem that needs to be addressed, but it's not it might be a problem, but not all problems are endemic. Not all problems sort of push that 51% line,
right.
in any sort of social situation, but still acknowledging that it's a problem. Like, one of the things that, like, as Americans, we don't really tend to understand is the difference between a plurality and a majority. Like,
mm-hmm.
a plurality is still a problem because it means that, you know, if I have four different factions and one gains a 26% majority and the rest of them are divided equally, like, that's a plurality. That means that not most of the people think that way, but like enough of them do to sort of tip that balance versus a majority, which means 51%. So, but we don't think that way. We think of things either being 51% or 49% in Western thought. Like, we don't really engage in that sort of gray territory. And I think that all of our social issues could really benefit from that sort of aspect, the sort of interpretation.
Well, you know, I talk to a lot of different people. I'm always interested in talking to people. So when I'm out fixing someone's computer, I'll talk to them. And I've never been one to push my beliefs on someone because my beliefs are always changing.
Have so, I talked to you about my Lord, you know, and Savior, always Cthulhu?
My view is I want to understand, you know, if they bring something up, you know, whether it be political or religious, I'll talk to them about it. It doesn't become an argument ever. Because I'm not there to change their mind. I want to understand why they see things this way. And I try to find common points between people. And you find that there's a lot of them. But people don't realize it because they think everything is so polarized. They look at if you're a liberal, the conservative is the enemy, and vice versa. When in reality, there's a lot of common ground. And one of the things I find most amusing is you talk about something like Congress, and people will say, "Oh yeah, they're all bums. We should kick them all out." And you get a overwhelming agreement. But then you look at Congress's reelection, ratio, and it's very, very high. And it's like, okay, their approval rating's like 20%, and their reelection percentage is like 90%. And the only thing I've been able to come down to is people say, "Well, it's not my congressman."
Right. Yep.
It's everyone else's.
It's never my fault. It's never my problem. You know? Which also to sort of like branch off of that, I've talked to many people out of the country who say like the Republican Democrat parties have much more in common than they don't. Which is just almost like we have two like right parties than we do have a right and a left party. which I think is worthy of examination. But I think that what it really comes down to. A sort of thumbnail sketch of one of the messages in the Bhagavad Gita that I come back to is the idea that the warrior and the pacifist have something in common if both their goals are true, which I think is something that gets overlooked in a lot of our discourse. Like, we all want the same thing, really. I mean, if we're not giant assholes. This is a midweek podcast, right? I can say that, right? Yes. If we're not giant assholes, like, we all want the same thing. We all want everybody to get along. We all want everybody to be equal. It's just a disagreement on how that should go about and on what sort of things should be placed, have a priority placed on them. And I think if we can sort of approach things from that aspect, it might help alleviate a lot of the social issues that we have. Again, I'm certainly like at least a plurality of people are jerks, but to me, like, again, like your personal politics are how you would, your personal politics come down to how you would rule the world if you could. And the idea that you're not going to, and the idea that that you have to compromise with people, if people could incorporate that into their worldview, it might actually make the world a better place. Welcome to Where Did the Politics Go? On Radio. Well,
But it's all about, but again, it's about perception too. And I mean, like, if you took like so you look at a libertarian, you ask them about healthcare, and they say, "Well, we think the best healthcare is this, and it's, you know, get rid of the government out of it and make people responsible for themselves, and you know, everyone will get along great and people will take care of one another." And then you look at the far opposite of that, which is the socialist sort of thing, and they'll say, "Well, we want to take care of everyone and we think the government is the best way to do that." It's not that their goals are different. It's that the libertarians think the government's just going to screw it up, whereas the socialist thinks the government is the best way to achieve that goal. Mm. It's the goals are the same. It's just the methodology that they believe in is different. And you're going to find if you talk to them long enough, you'll understand why they feel that way. You know, the libertarian may have seen horrible things that the government has done, has, you know, had maybe personal experiences where they've been screwed over on things they shouldn't have been screwed over on, whereas the socialist may have had great experiences dealing with the government or some form of government and has looked at, you know, other cultures or new people from other cultures who had a healthcare system that the government ran and it worked great. You know, and you find it's those, that perspective that really kind of divides things up. The problem with our culture, though, is that everything has to be black or white.
Yeah, but there's neither also, is right, neither is wrong. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, well, but there's also an element of social engineering going on. You know, not to stray too deep into, you know, conspiratorial waters. But, you know, a lot of reasons that people think the way they do is because they've been fed. You know, going back to my, you know, Facebook example of, you know, you've got channels of information that come to you, you know, which is why one person will believe that, "Oh my God, I need to stockpile, you know, hundreds of guns in my house to stay safe," while another person might think that all those people stockpiling all those guns are crazy. And there are reasons people believe what they do, and those reasons are tied to the media they consume, you know, which is becoming increasingly, you know, owned by smaller and smaller groups of individuals and organizations, and with an agenda. Yeah. And now, of course, when you start to parse that agenda, that's when things break down. And that's when some of the, to me, the really crazy, far end of the conspiratorial spectrum comes in. But it's not conspiratorial to look at it realistically and say, well, you know, where we get our information comes from these particular channels, and what agenda do these channels have? Why are they telling us this instead of that? And, you know, I don't want to go to where the political road go, you know, again, with my particular opinions. But, you know, it's critical that we understand it's not just that people want the same thing. They just have different beliefs. It's that people have different beliefs because of what they are taught and what they consume as well. Yes. You know, so that's the big cloud over the issue of what people want. Well, and how they want it.
And to sort of build off that, I would contend that there is much more ancestor worship in the U.S. than people want to admit. especially, ironically enough, in the Christian South, where, like, this is what my father did, and this is what my father's father did, and we're going to do that, too. Which I think, I mean, I think there's a lot of respect in, like, you know, holding on to family antiques and family pieces. But I think that's an aspect that doesn't get addressed in that sense. It just gets, like, lumped into this, like, sort of heritage thing. Mm-hmm. But it really is sort of a weird sort of backwards form of ancestor worship.
Yeah.
That's an interesting way of looking at it. And, I mean, when we look at some of the recent events here that happened last week with the whole Black Lives Matter, at the same time you have a kid getting killed by a cop for no good reason, you know, and again, you have that divide where people are like, well, all cops are bad. Well, that's certainly not true. But there are certainly going to be bad cops, and there always have been bad cops. And, you know, I think Jon Stewart had said it best, where he said something akin to, you know, we can at the same time realize that we need to do something about this escalating violence, especially toward minorities, you know, from the cops, while at the same time recognizing that most police officers are good people out there trying to do a good job.
Well, there's, you know, when I get attacked from people on the right and from people on the left, I feel like maybe I'm on the right track. You know, and it's true. I mean, I've, you know, the stuff I've posted that sort of encourages that idea, you know, is that stop, like, we can address the fact that there is institutionalized racism and that the police are often the enforcers of the institutionalized racism in this country. But at the same time, that, you know, the guy who's saying, I mean, I know people who say we don't need police at all. And I say, okay, well, when, you know, the jackass next door who decides he's had enough of you and is pounding on your door and coming in to kill you, maybe, you know, who are you going to call then? You know, not Ghostbusters. You know, yeah, I mean, you're going to call. There always needs to be some sort of authority to protect public safety. Okay. So these nitwits who are, you know, telling me, you know, F the police and, you know, we don't need police. We need, you know, there are society. I say, show me the society that doesn't have some form of, you know, control of public safety control. So, you know, it's again, you know, we're going back to that. What we've all been sort of circling around is the idea that you have to look and listen to different sides and not confine yourself to the easy, you know, easy side you can jump on. And without thinking, you know, it's critical thinking. And critical thinking is the root of our problems of all the stuff we talk about. You know, the lack of critical thinking that makes people say, I don't believe in that UFO crap, or, you know, or the, you know, or the person who says, you know, I don't believe in science, you know, it's all the same thing. It's a lack of critical thinking skills is like at the root of all this.
And some of it's just pure laziness. And we've been conditioned to dismiss certain things like UFOs. I mean, that is something that the both the media and the government literally, you know, went through great pains to ridicule. But and so at the same time, it's like, okay, it's understandable. It's like, but if you, the thing is, people don't care. So if they don't care, it's easy for them to just be lazy and dismiss it without ever looking at it. And if they do look at it, if I sit down and talk to someone, you know, of course, the first thing they do is try to divide it up. Either you don't believe in UFOs or you think they're aliens. And, you know, that's always the first part of the, okay, let's reset this. There's something going on, but we don't know what it is.
Yeah, I remember one time Richard Dolan talked about, like, the conversation that you have with people on an airplane when they ask you what you do in this field. And what I've come around to, my first statement always is, I read about unexplained things like Bigfoot and UFOs, but what you think I think is not what I think. that's sort of been like my go-to thing because there's this. Again, it comes back to the sort of this thing that's not only in terms of Fortiana, but also like in terms of politics in general, is this overly simplified narrative. Like it's either this or this. There's no room for nuance. There's no room for alternative thinking. You have to be put into a camp and think that. And if the prevailing view wins, you reap the benefits. And if it doesn't, then you're, you know, ostracized, pushed to the margins.
The truth is not. I mean, the truth can be simple, but it's usually. Like when we're dealing with this stuff, the truth is not so simple.
It's always complex.
Yeah. I mean, there are simple truths. We should treat each other with respect. Mm-hmm. That's a simple truth. You know, but when we're dealing with these subjects, when we're dealing with science and people and politics, to just jump on one side or the other, it's not that simple. Sometimes I'll tell people I'm a libertarian socialist. And they just kind of look at me like, well, how does that make any sense? The truth is because I believe that we should go with the ideas that make most sense. I don't care which side they come from. So I've just taken the two extreme perspectives and said, okay, anything in between these two that makes sense is what we should go with. I don't care what you call it.
That's funny because I went on a blind date once. Well, actually, no, it wasn't a blind date. It was a second date with this woman. And we went out on a sort of a double date with me and her friend and her friend's husband or something. And the friend looked at me, and this is dating myself here, okay? Dating as in chronologically. I've always dated myself.
I would date you, Mike.
Well, this woman says to me, she goes, I looked on your MySpace profile. Okay, that's how I'm dating myself. I looked on your MySpace profile, and you had yourself listed. You said your religion was Buddhist Christian. And she's like, that's ridiculous. How could you be a Buddhist and a Christian? And I said, well, I that's what I believe. She's like, but you can't. You can't be a Buddhist and a Christian. It's impossible. And I'm like, no, it's not impossible. You're looking at me right now. Okay. I consider myself, you know, at the time, those were the two, you know, religious sensibilities that made the most sense to me. And she was furious. I mean, it almost ended the whole evening. She's like, you can't do that. And I said, the hell, I can't do that. I'm doing it right now. And it, you know, finally, you know, the woman I was dating went on the date was just like, let's just talk about something else, please. You know? And, but it was, but that's the libertarian socialist thing. You know, it's like, no, you have to be this or you have to be that, you know, well, you have to be, and like, it's absurd.
Like Michael Hughes sitting in the Fortfest hotel room saying, can we please talk about UFOs?
Yes. Like, can we please get back to UFOs and ghosts and Sasquatch?
But it's almost like people want to walk into life with this, like, role-playing game template of what they should be.
Right. I am a fighter warrior with 18 hit points.
Exactly.
And I'm neutral good, and that shall never change.
Yeah, and to me, like, the real meaning of existence is to adopt this sort of syncretic cafeteria-style belief system. Like, I think that's a really good idea. I should take that. And I think that this other idea isn't part of my belief structure, but I think that it will augment part of my belief structure. And that's the way that you cobble together your own spiritual / practical worldview.
Yes.
But nobody seems to get that, and that's why we have two awful choices for president. So.
Well, you know, even with religion, you have people who will proclaim themselves one particular religion, but unless they're a fundamentalist, they don't fully necessarily believe or act within the beliefs of that religion.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
They kind of just take the parts that they like, and that's what they go with, and that's fine. The point is, you don't have to. And you know, I could look at all these different religions, and I've studied all these different religions earlier in my life, and I found that I agree with parts of all of them. They all have good points to make. A lot of them make the same point in a different way. You know, for the most part, religions aren't out there to hurt the people.
Right, but bring it back to Fortiana. You know, no, UFOs are, there's the Nordics and the Greys, and they come from here, and then the reptilians are this and that. You know, it's the same thing. I mean, at a previous Ford Fest years ago, one of my pet peeves is the whole, you know, crisis actor thing. And, you know, I ran into a guy who was saying, no, you know, all the people who died in Newtown were actors, you know, and you know, all this kind of stuff. And it's like, so it's easy in any, you know, system that you believe in to fall into a fundamentalist mindset. And it's a cancer. It's a toxin. That is really the root. I mean, the hardcore belief and fundamentalism is, you know, really, I think, what we all sort of rail against in so many different ways. And that's why people like podcasts like this, because we're like, well, we don't know. You know, we're asking questions about this stuff. I don't, you know, if Soraya came on, you know, next week and said, oh, it's the Zeta Reticulans, man. I figured it out.
If I did say that, well, that would be fine as long as I had some solid, hardcore evidence to back it up.
But then, I'd be like, I don't know, what the hell happened to Soraya?
but you know, conspiracy theories too. They there seem to be two main camps: the people who think there are no conspiracy theories, and the people who think there's only conspiracy. Exactly. Everything that happens is a conspiracy. And it's like, okay, look, conspiracies happen. They happen all the time. We have evidence that our government has been involved in conspiracies.
So here's my take on the whole thing, because I have an uncle who was born in Mahmoudia, and he is an Iraqi expatriate and has had some assets frozen back during the first Persian Gulf War. And he's someone that you talk to, and God knows he's the most affable, like, warmest human being you ever met. I love him to death. Mm-hmm. But I remember one time when I was in my, like, late teens, early 20s, when I said, Mom, I said, half the stuff he says is probably, half the stuff that I think is real is probably bullshit, and half the stuff I think is bullshit is probably true. You know, it's that weird, position where, again, liminality. Where the things that you think that have no credence do, and the things that you don't think have any credence actually are kind of have a real solid grain of truth. And I think that sort of attitude in all these things, including conspiracy theories, like the most outlandish things probably are true. And the things that seem the most mundane that you don't agree with probably aren't. You know, it's just a matter of accepting the fact that you don't know anything, and that, like, your expectations probably are off balance because of the culture that you live in.
Yes. The I had been listening to a podcast where it was basically this guy ripping apart conspiracy theories. And he was making all these points, like, you know, he talks to someone and they say, well, this is why I believe 9/11, you know, was a conspiracy. And he's like, okay, did you actually look into this to see if there was any evidence to support it? Well, I'm going to. And he's like, but you just said you believe it. And she's like, well, yeah, I mean, it sounds reasonable. No, I'll look into it eventually. And I'm thinking, okay, no, here he's making a very good point. But the problem is, at the end, his whole thing was, there are no conspiracies. People just believe this stuff because they want to or because they're convinced. And it's like, no. You were making good points here. People should look into this stuff. They should think critically about it. But then you just threw it all away by being, you know, this absolute no conspiracies. It's like, do you not know history?
If you think that the Manhattan Project existed, you believe in conspiracies.
Exactly.
Because that was a thing that existed and kept a secret about something that was very serious, and it totally existed. Like, it's what, for three or more people is the definition of a conspiracy, right?
Well, no, conspiracy comes from conspire, which means to breathe together. So it could be two people. Yeah. You know, hatching an idea to do something that they're keeping secret from other people, and that happens every day to all.
And there's a Where Did the Road Go conspiracy, because we're talking about what we're going to talk about next time. Like, it's not that sophisticated, well, people.
And realistically, if you look at 9/11, there was a conspiracy one way or another, because from the idea that our government was in on it and it was a conspiracy, to the idea that they told us the absolute truth and these terrorists got together and created a conspiracy to take down the towers. Right. One way or another, it was a conspiracy. It's just a matter of from what perspective. Exactly. And when we look at things we know and we don't know, I've always had this analogy. It's like you go out and you buy like an acre of land, and you didn't actually look at the land. Someone gave you a good price on it. You looked at it, say, from an aerial view, and you see, oh, it's full of trees. Okay, so there's my acre of land. And the first time you go out to it, you walk all the way around the outskirts of it, because it's thick trees, and you kind of just walk around the outside, and then you feel like, well, now I know this land a little better, because now instead of just seeing it from a computer screen, I've now walked around it. And then, you know, the first time you walk into it, you learn a little more about it. And you go, okay, so the things I believed when I first walked around it don't seem to be quite as accurate as I thought they were now that I've walked through it. And the more you explore it, the more you find, and the more you see it differently than you did from that first view, from that second view, from that third view. And then, you know, maybe you start digging down and you start exploring the history of the land, and now it looks even different. And by the time you get to a certain point, there's no point where you're actually done. But when you look back from where you started and what you believed about where you started and where you are now, unless you're just ignoring all that information, your perspective is completely different because of what you've done to explore this land or this subject or whatever you want to use as a connector there.
That the map is not the territory, once again. Yep, takes us full circle.
Yeah. And the problem, too, is that I think people we create kind of like circles. So we say, let's use computer stuff for instance. So somebody doesn't know much about computers. They're playing around with it, and they figure out how to remove some malware. Well, now they've made a circle where they can say, I have malware. I know how to fix it, so now I don't have malware. And they think, I know stuff about computers. But they don't know a lot about computers, but they don't know what they actually know. They just know that they've made this complete circle. Things make sense to them now. And that happens with any subject. You learn a little bit and you think, oh, no, I got this. And then you go into the deep end of the pool and you go, okay, wait, what's happening? But when we make that circle, it makes us feel like we have knowledge. And we have no perspective as to how much knowledge we have compared to how much is out there. And really, the what's out there is almost infinite.
Well, it sort of reminds me of my favorite quote attributed to
Patrick Harper?
No, not Patrick Harper, but Pablo
Casals. Patrick Swayze?
Oh, okay. No, Pablo Casals. which is a quote that's sort of dubious in nature, but supposedly someone asked Pablo Casals, a cellist, why he continued to practice at his advanced age, and he says, because I think I'm learning something. And that sort of dovetails into all this about the idea that you're constantly seeking the answer, and even if you're advanced, and even if you're at the top of your game, you still have so much to learn. And that it's not that you, like, learn what you know and you sit back and say, I'm enlightened. But you are continuing to sift and winnow throughout all your endeavors.
Mm-hmm. And when, before I did this show, on my music show, The Last Exit for the Lost, myself and my co-host Eric, one of the things when I was thinking about doing this show, I'm like, can I handle doing this show? Do I know enough to actually put a good, you know, grounded show together and talk to authors and stuff about this and not sound like an idiot? Because honestly, no. I didn't have a lot of people. I didn't have a lot of people who I knew who, you know, like I could talk to people about this stuff, but I knew more than they did. So I'm saying, okay, when I'm going to have these authors on, when they're experts on this stuff compared to where I am I going to come off like an idiot? And I had a friend who's a co-host on the music show occasionally, and it was just he and I one night, and I said, let's take each talk break and talk about something paranormal, conspiratorial, whatever. And, you know, we went through that, and I was like, okay, that went well. The listeners really liked it. People were like, you should do this more. And it's like, okay, all right. And that kind of gave me a little confidence towards starting this show. But I can pretty much guarantee if I went back, that was maybe 4 years ago, if I went back and listened to that, I would find myself going, I don't believe that anymore. Nope, don't believe that anymore. No, I was totally wrong there.
But I think that's important because, like, I've become kind of set in the last 3 to 4 months in a lot of my opinions, and it terrifies me because I don't want to be in that place. Like, I want to continue to grow. And hopefully somebody will kick my butt out of this rut that I'm in. But I'm in a very much sort of magico-mystical perspective about all these things. Won't be reflected in any of my literature because my last book was sent off to the publisher before I arrived at this conclusion. But I've been sort of toying with that. But, like, it bothers me. Like, and that's sort of something that's unique to the paranormal, is because I feel like the people who are truly interested in it are bothered by the idea of coming to a conclusion. Which I think I could speak with for all of us when I say that, like, the fact, if you settle on a conclusion, you become Stephen Greer, you become Renee de Hinden, you know, you become these people who are married to this one viewpoint and throw out all other outliers. And I don't want to be that person. I don't think any of us talking here want to be that person either. So whenever I have that moment, like, sort of creep into my periphery, I'm really quite anxious about it.
Well, it's, that's why I think you can be immutable. You know, just like both of you guys, I mean, my ideas, my beliefs, my understanding of things have mutated, you know, as I've gone along, I've been exposed to other thoughts and ideas, and that's really what keeps, you know, the idea that you're still seeking, you know, knowledge and information. I think it's, you know, even though you may feel like you're sort of becoming set in your ways, you're not, you know. I can't imagine if something came and, you know, twisted your perception in a different direction that you wouldn't incorporate that into your viewpoint. And it's okay to feel comfortable with certain ideas, but I think you're not always going to be comfortable with those ideas. You're going to change. If you're comfortable with the idea that your beliefs will change, I think that's what makes it okay. You know, that's what makes it okay to be, you know, I'm going to be a ceremonial magician for 3 years. Okay. Then I'm going to go back to Christian mysticism. Then I'm going to go and, you know, and play around in folk customs and beliefs, and you know, and then I'm going to go back heavy into science. It's okay, you know, because each time you move into a different realm, you're picking up little bits and pieces there from that buffet you talked about. And it's interesting that a lot of people, they criticize a lot of New Age culture for being a buffet, especially traditional religious people. You know, oh, New Age people, you know, they just pick and choose from here and there. And, you know, to some extent, I do think it's good to stick with a tradition and ride out a tradition, you know, whatever it might be. You know, I did a lot of Golden Dawn magic for a while, and that was great. I mean, it was deeply immersed in that Kabbalistic worldview, and it was cool. I had some amazing experiences, picked up a lot of knowledge, but then I sort of shifted, you know, and it's so while it's good to work with a tradition, because there's a lot of knowledge and a lot of wisdom and a lot of traditions, it's also the picking and choosing buffet style is not necessarily a bad thing. It could be a good thing because you pick from one group of thoughts and ideas, and then you carry that with you to the next. So you're building as you're going along. You're not just like haphazardly, you know, stuffing yourself at the salad bar, you know, before you run over to the dessert bar.
Well, it's almost as if a primary belief system is like a primer coat, you know, and then you get to like add your supplemental coats of paint on top of that.
Right. And you're just, you know, as the old layer gets rusted and worn out, you slap a fresh coat on top of it. So, you're building something. You're not just jumping willy-nilly from one thing to another.
The last night on the last exit, I had someone who had stopped into the studio, and he started telling me about some of these weird experiences he had, and they're very weird experiences. I'm hoping I can get him on the show to actually talk to them, whether it be just a listener. And I am doing, for people who have asked, I am doing a listener stories episode. I just have to get some time to collect them. And I have a few people with a bunch of stories, so they may end up being their own show rather than trying to squeeze them in, because I don't really like limiting people. I don't have to limit people, so why should I? But he started telling me these weird stories, and I don't want to get it totally into it, but one of the things he found is he would find himself talking to what he thought were other people, and this was in an altered state of some sorts. And he had mentioned this to somebody else who apparently was into UFOs and stuff, and the first thing the person said to them is, stay away from them, they're demons. And I was like, but do they feel like they're evil to you? He's like, well, no. And I'm like, then why would you listen to that? Ugh. You know, it's just, it's that immediate just, you know, anything that's not this is this, you know? So, oh, they're demons. They're trying to steal your soul and stuff like this. And then he had said, he was telling me about a UFO sighting he had, and the same guy was was trying to tell him he probably had missing time and he might have an implant, and he was checking his hands to see if he could find an implant, and he started telling them where the different aliens were from. And I was like, okay, I'm like, let me give you a different scenario and see which one makes more sense. And, you know, and of course what I told, you know, because basically he saw a light, and the light moved in ways that aircraft shouldn't move. And he didn't really know that he had any missing time. He didn't have anything else weird happen to him. And, you know, but we have that, especially in our paranormal culture in the West, that you know, that's a UFO, and here's what happens when you see a UFO.
Yeah, and the whole demon thing comes back to my weariness of the way that Christianity tends to shove things into a black or white box, which I hate so much.
Yes.
I really do hate so much.
No. We were also talking before we started this, which has been a fairly long midweek podcast for us. And we'll mention this again, but we're going to start to collect questions from listeners. And this was kind of your guys' ideas. Why don't you explain what you want people to do?
Well, it's like an AMA, you know, ask me anything, throw your questions, throw your thoughts out to us for us to discuss on the podcast. Pretty simple.
And hopefully you can address those to Mike or myself or Miguel, and we'll all be on one singular podcast to address all those.
We're just throw it out for the panel. You know, yeah. we're happy to take questions for everybody too, because I'm sure we all have different thoughts and ideas on them.
Yeah.
So it can be a personal question or it can be a general question.
And I would suggest the two points of focus for those to be either a focused post on the Where Did the Road Go Facebook page, which will be like, hey, here's the place to post your questions for the upcoming midweek podcast, or a similar post on the forums of Where Did the Road Go. So just the forums and just Facebook, those will be what we're addressing. If you send stuff over Twitter, it'll probably get lost in the noise. So
yeah, do not send stuff over Twitter. I am horrible.
Well, Twitter's sort of a noisy I love Twitter in its own sort of way, but it's sort of a noisy platform in and of itself. Because
yeah, I have trouble tracking stuff down that I need to go find after I've read it. You can also email me. You can use one of the emails on wheredidtheroadgo.com.
But really looking forward to... Sorry, go ahead.
I guess you could also message the Facebook page, and I'll try to just kind of collect them all together. Because some people might want to throw them out there without putting them out publicly.
Yes,
so.
And any efforts to keep anonymity will be respected as best we can. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely. All right. So I guess we should conclude there.
We've covered quite a bit tonight.
a pleasure as always. As Mike Cleland often says, if you start talking about UFOs and you don't end up at the greater questions of what reality and life is, then you've missed the point. So I think we've covered that territory quite well.
Politics, religion, geez, what didn't we touch on tonight?
Sex.
And I do want to be clear that we, and I think you two agree with me on this, we totally respect everyone's beliefs and their viewpoints on this stuff. We're just looking to understand them and open them up where possible.
Absolutely.
Yeah, man. Except for really stupid beliefs. We don't disrespect those.
Not those people. Jeez.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, man. It was a great time as always.